This is Sarah. She's probably going to be interrupting this video because I am near the kitchen, and of course, according to her, the only reason to be in the kitchen is to feed her. And when she wants to be fed, she sounds like she hasn't been fed in weeks. So that is Sarah, and this is the Western Electric 1D2 payphone. I got it off of eBay about a week ago. And Western Electric was the manufacturing arm of AT&T up until the breakup in the early 80s. After that, it became independent, but still serviced the Baby Bells. So basically, when you see Western Electric, because they also did the all of AT&T's personal phones, just think, you know, AT&T manufacturing. Again, this is the Western Electric 1D2, which is basically like a modular platform. A lot of what Western Electric did was very modular. So, when we open this up, you'll actually see dates, from, I think I've seen as early as 1980 and as late as 1990, date stamps and everything, because everything's modular, they can just, you know, if something breaks, they just, replace it with a replacement part. It could also be upgraded over time. This is one of the last dumb payphones, in that pretty much everything is covered from all the functionality is covered from the telco side, and so it's actually really easy to convert these to home use. It is fully working at the moment. I've got a ATA adapter set up here, going from Ethernet across the way here, and that just converts it to from normal plain old telephone service to SIP. So I can actually pick this up, get a dial tone. I can. It's kind of hard to do this here, but. That does work there, and I can take money, put it in, and it does go down to the vault there. There are a couple modifications needed, which I will I'll show you in a bit, but I do have this set up to trunk into my. My home PBX, so I can actually do some tests here. Hang this up here. This one will be for caller ID. And then it goes to hold music after many of these applications I've written. Here's another one which probably won't work well with this demo. It's an echo test. So, testing, 1, 2, 3, testing. And probably the easiest one to demonstrate here is going to be the ring back test. So it just says thank you for calling, it waits for you to hang up, and a couple seconds later, pick it up here. And that's it. I've got those on my PBX because it makes testing out equipment easy. Complete, should I say. So yeah, I got this about a week ago off of eBay. The problem with buying payphones I found on eBay, and why I've waited so long until doing this, is There are several caveats. Number one will be, and go over here, the contrast works here. See there are two holes there, one for the vault door, and or for the vault itself, and one for the upper housing. And basically what that is are places for locks. There is this, which is called a T-key, and that's just because it forms a T-shape, and that is for the, this would be for unlocking the upper housing, and then of course this for the vault door. The T-key is basically secondary security. The primary security is going to be the actual locks. And the if the locks are there in something you buy off eBay, but not but you don't have the keys, then you're basically out of luck. I mean, these are designed to be put in unguarded public places, and it is very heavy. The entire thing here is about 50 pounds, and if you have a locked unit but don't have the key for it, you basically have but a week of drilling. I've heard that there are people that have been able to drill out the locks on these, but a week may be exaggerating, but it is definitely multiple days. So the best deal that you would get would be a phone that had the keys and the lock mechanism already intact. This just did not come with the lock at all, the locks, but not terrible. I can buy replacements. They are kind of pricey. Even the used stuff is going to be like $25 a lock, and it's perfectly functional for home use without those locks. So to get it open, this goes in, and for the upper housing, why aren't you? Yeah, interesting. Oh, jump cut. The problem was that the T-key was actually in an unlocked state, which you're not supposed to be able to remove the key when it's in unlocked state, but it is possible, but difficult. Somehow I found a way. So anyway, take this, goes in here. It's currently in a locked state, so the key actually goes in, not very far, just little bit there, and then all you do is turn it about an eighth of a turn counterclockwise, and now the upper housing is unarmed, or is unlocked. And let me lock that again, and to unlock the vault door, let me take this out of the way. This kind of goes in, again counterclockwise, about an eighth of a turn, and the entire vault door comes off. And this is what it looks like. When you're turning it, it actually has four different points that just come out like this. Let me try to show you there. And at this point, the key has fallen off, which means it's actually in a locked state right now. Defaults to locked whenever, so kind of hard to do one-handed here. But that, and now it is in a unlocked state. So let me take this off, put this in, unlock. So both the upper housing and the vault door are unlocked now. Both require two hands, and in the upper housing, probably four hands to get off safely. Let me put this down and I will show you it with everything removed. Okay, this is everything removed. Let me start with the vault box here, the coin box. And I've just removed it from the casing here. And this is what it would look like if somebody's making their rounds to collect the coins from the payphones. And you'll see here, there is a little slot there, and you could either put a very tiny lock on there, or like a nylon locking loop on there. And that is not necessarily to prevent theft by the people collecting, but make it tamper evident. So the idea would be there'd be like a nylon loop locked on here, and if it was removed at the central office, you know that the guy collecting the coin boxes maybe tried to do something with it. And you'll notice this is where the coins will actually fall down into. There's no way to get into it right now. You can't even push this. So this makes it tamper evident. So you would remove the nylon loop at the central office, open this up, and then inside are just a box with some coins in it. And now, what happens when the when it is removed, when the coins are removed, is this can actually not be put back into the coin box in its current state, or into the payphone. And again, this is all part of the tamper evident features on this phone. So what they would do at the central office, or collection center or whatever, is take a Phillips or a flathead screwdriver and turn this a quarter turn, and now it is armed again. So what happens? Let me get this back on here. Is so get some better light here. When this is slid back into the payphone, there's a catch at the back that will open up and hold it like that. And then when it is removed, that swings back down. And then anytime that happens, this process has to be repeated again. Another jump cut there. Accidentally stopped recording. But yeah, anytime that the coin box goes back into the payphone, it basically needs to be rearmed. And that is more for making sure that the people collecting the coins aren't taking some for themselves. That is also the reason why there are two different keys here, one for the coin box and one for the upper housing. The coin box vault is the key and lock for that are usually unique, and people collecting coins usually just have a big key ring of different payphones. The vault or the upper housing is usually shared for like a geographic area, and the reason they're separated is because you don't want the technicians to be able to get into the coin vault. So the technicians can come, they can remove the upper housing, they can work on it, and it's just a little bit of a separation of security here. The actual parts of the payphone itself, it's roughly divided into two halves. You get the left half with the coin mechanism, and the right half with the main board. And the main board is actually not much different than a normal telephone. It's got the same components. It's got the keypad, which is on the front of the upper housing. The handset itself, that all goes via this little connector, which has a interesting circular shape on it, and then that goes into a slot right there. And then there's a bell ringer at the top,
And, not much more to it than that. There is this ribbon cable which goes from the main board to the coin mechanism. The way the coin mechanism works is when I insert a coin, it travels through here, and there is a, I believe, an electromagnet right around here, and basically says, does this have enough of a signature that I trust it to be a real coin? That if that does not happen, actually open this up here, can't really see into it, but at any stage along the way, it can drop right or to the left and go down into the reject slot. So if it's not metal, it goes to the left. If it's something that doesn't look like a coin that can recognize, it goes to the left slot. If it makes it down here, that's where it actually determines the value of the coin. And again, there's a way for it to reject at that stage as well. If it makes it all the way down, there is a little pivoting plastic thing here, and that is where the coins will sit. Remember, this is a pretty dumb phone. It's not, basically, it can tell what money is, but it relies on the telco. It'll tell the telco how much is being inserted, and the telco can then, at some stage, send a different voltage, and that tells this mechanism here to push in and release all of the coins, which have basically accumulated like this, are being stacked down into the vault. You'll see that this is basically wired shut, because there are a lot of things that, like Asterisk, can do for a soft PBX. It cannot, do those sorts of payphone functionality, such as changing the voltage on the line, that sort of thing. Number one, that's part of the ATA and not the PBX itself. And number two, you just don't see ATAs that are capable of doing that. So when this goes in, it goes all through this and then ends up at the bottom. If that didn't happen, if this wasn't here, it would hit the stage and just kind of rest there, and then this would start getting clogged up, and because there's no way to tell the phone to empty this slot. So that's really the only modification that's needed. The only other configuration is this panel of dip switches here. That controls what is needed for the initial payphone, for the initial coins. So when you pick up the handset, normally you'll get a dial tone, but it's going to be somewhat muffled, and you're not going to be able to talk into the handset. And that is because you could take what's called a red box, basically a tone generator, and generate the tones on this model to simulate inserting money, and that's what happened up through basically the early 80s. And this sort of thing was, I wouldn't say it's commonplace, but it was definitely part of the 2600, the freaker movement. And so what the payphone manufacturers did was counteract that with a little bit of a smarter setup that you see here. And it is, you set dip switches. I believe it's number one and number three. I'll have to look at my documentation, but that equals 25 cents. And that tells the phone, wait until 25 cents has been inserted. And when that happens, give full control to the handset. So until that happens, you can't use a red box to simulate money being put in. Now, what you're probably thinking right now is, well, can't I just insert a payphone or
why can't I insert a quarter and then dial a long distance number and then use a red box to continue talking indefinitely? And you could. These are not that smart. And once the handset is unlocked, that's basically it. There's, you know, everything is controlled by the telco on the remote end, except for initial coin insertion. So, I mean, that's really all you need to do to convert one of these. This is kind of specific to my my phone here, these instructions, because the coin assembly is, in this case, an AT&T 22A, manufactured February 1990. I can't remember what the designation for the main board is, but this sort of system persisted until the late 90s, and after that, these phones started getting smarter because you could just rip out this these units and replace them with upgraded boards. So the manufacturers after the mid to late 90s would start adding things that that handled its own smarts, basically. It would have a graph or a table internally that said, you know, to be able to dial a long distance number, you need to start with this amount of money. For a 911 call, it's going to be free, just, you know, process it. Whereas, you know, the 22A and this board, nothing like that. But because this is all modular, these are all standardized designs, that's, you know, you're going to see 1D2 Western Electric platforms, you know, that have, you know, similar or even the same housing as this, just with completely different innards to it. So if you buy on eBay, be careful. This was kind of like the golden age of modern telephones before they got too modern, I guess I'd say. So after this, you'll see models that you may not be able to reprogram, or you'll have trouble finding documentation and the means to actually use them. Before this are the older pulse dial and three coin models, but this was basically it until the late 90s. So let me get this assembled again, and I'm going to show you some of the other phones I have, kind of explain why I have this payphone. Forgot to mention, the phone actually came with information cards, but you could tell the seller had gone on to Google image search, found them, printed out really low resolution copies, and put them in there. It, you know, decent sentiment, but I wanted to do something better. So I printed these out myself, designed and printed pretty much everything except for, I did admit that I did steal that corner design from something I found online, or should I say redid it. So Velociraptor Aerospace Dynamics now has a new subsidiary, Badtel, with its world famous slogan, reach out and insert a coin. Standard dial 911, which seems to be on all the top cards. And then let me move this. The bottom card is a little bit of a clone of a Ameritech card that I found, just with information replaced and everything done in a high resolution. Went to Kinko's or FedEx office or whatever it's called these days to get that printed, rather than spend about $2 on full color cardstock printout, rather than spending $50 trying to get my color inkjet printer filled with ink and actually working again, which I don't really want to do. So people ask me, why did I buy this? What am I going to do with it? And the answer I give them is the same answer to the question of why did I buy 10 acres of land in the middle of the desert? What am I going to do with it? The answer is,
it was interesting, and I could afford it. So this was about $200, I should say, that I did wait for so long. Number one, because of the key issue. Number two, because I wanted something decent quality. A lot of the payphones you see on eBay are going to be really banged up. This, the seller said, was only used in a indoor area, so that was nice. I mean, it's got really, you know, shiny chrome, no major damage on it, very little rust. Yeah, it was $200. So the average price, I would say, of a working payphone starts at $350 and only goes up from there. So wait until I got a decent bargain on it. So I don't know why I like phones, and here's a small part of my collection, specifically desk phones. I've got a small collection of cell phones as well, but frankly, I don't find that as interesting as this for some reason. Here you've got three hotel phones, and they're all made by a company called Teledex. And Teledex basically just specializes in hospitality and hotel phones. So starting on the right here is the Teledex. Why is the face recognition going on this? That's interesting. Is the Teledex Opal, and it's pretty much a standard landline phone with the addition. You'll see these on all the hotel phones, is the message waiting indicator, and modern ATAs can actually tie into your voicemail account on a PBX such as Asterisk, and actually light that message waiting indicator. So these phones are actually fully functional these days. All you need is a cheap ATA adapter, and I'll get to that in a minute, and Asterisk, and then, you know, like if you want to have outside connectivity, you know, get a find a SIP provider such as like VoIP.ms. Teledex Opal, this one actually came from the Gaylord Opryland hotel that I've actually stayed in just outside of Nashville, and the reason why they were selling this, or should I say a reseller was selling this on eBay many years ago, 2010, I believe it was, there was a massive flood in Nashville, and basically destroyed the first floor of the Opryland. And the Opryland is a mass. I think it's the world's largest non-gaming hotel, but it's all basically towards the ground. There's only like two or three floors on it, so a large chunk of it was actually destroyed by this flood. So this, you know, there's no sign of flood damage or anything, so I'm guessing that when they rebuilt the Opryland, they basically just you know, installed a completely new phone system. This all happened since I was there, so who knows, I might have actually you know, stayed in, what was that, D5116? Probably not likely, but so yeah, Teledex Opal. It's got, I mean, okay, yeah, you're gonna see these on pretty much any hotel that you stay at. It's got the standard line there. That's for plugging in the modem that nobody has anymore, volume control, etc., etc., etc. This is the other one, and that's a Teledex Diamond. The mnemonic I have for that is the diamonds are kind of diamond-shaped keys, just turned 45 degrees. Opal is more rounded. This came from the Riviera, which was just recently closed down, and I'm not sure if it's been imploded yet, but Riviera Hotel and Casino in Vegas. And I have stayed several times at the Riv because they used to hold the hold DEF CON there for a couple of years. So I actually know for a fact that I have stayed on the 20th floor of the primary tower. So I've got probably like a 1 in 30 chance that I've actually been in the phone that had, or been in the room that had this phone. You can tell it's a little bit hard to tell on the video output here, but this one is a lot more yellowed than that one. I'm willing to bet that a couple million cigarettes may have had something to do with the quality of this. Bought this off eBay a couple weeks ago. Required some light soldering because the primary port wasn't working. But interestingly, I could actually plug the line in through the data port and work. But got out the soldering iron, fixed up a couple things, and worked great after that. This is an iPhone. Actually, you know, this is a iPhone that I'm recording on, but this phone right here is also an iPhone. It is a Teledex iPhone. And yes, that is real. There were multiple manufacturers of iPhones before Apple even introduced their iPhone. And this is legal. There's there are different classes of trademarks that you can register for different categories. A cell phone is basically treated as differently than a landline phone, things like that. So there were multiple iPhone manufacturers out there long before. Teledex later renamed this the I series, so I have a feeling that they and Apple actually worked something out after that. It's the difference between this and these two is this is actually a SIP phone. And that was kind of their I series, their iPhone series. It was all digital. And there's a line in, Ethernet in, and there's also a pass-through Ethernet. There's actually no power going to it. So you actually had to use either a switch that was capable of doing power over Ethernet, or for home use, it's something like this. And power and Ethernet going on this side, and this side goes into here and provides both the power and Ethernet on one set of wires. So that is the Teledex iPhone. That's how you call Batman. This is a Western Electric Model 2500, which was the successor to the Model 500, which was pretty much the same, but just had the round pulse dialing. And normally they came with opaque covers, and indeed mine did as well, but just as a little bit of a I went on an eBay kick a couple weeks ago and for telco related stuff and found somebody selling clear plexiglass covers, so I bought one of those. Looks interesting. These were actually sometimes used as hotel phones, usually, or sometimes with its own message waiting indicator, which would be right around here, but otherwise the exact same functionality, just because, I mean, these things are nearly indestructible. When I was reassembling the payphone, actually dropped the handset. Of course, no damage, because it's probably been done hundreds of thousands of times. These are almost as indestructible. Interestingly, it is actually not built by, this is not a true Western Electric. It's actually made by a company called Cortelco. And this is upside down for you, but if you know ancient computer stuff, you may know that IBM made the Model M keyboard. And then they sold the designs and right to manufacture to Lexmark, who makes printers now. Lexmark spun that off to an independent company called, trying to remember their name right now, but there's a third manufacturer that is currently making IBM Model M's. Unicomp is the name of the company, and you can buy a model. They don't call it Model M anymore, but you can buy essentially the exact same molding process, guts inside it, that sort of thing, even though it's 25 years later. This is kind of the same thing. After Western Electric went out of business, they sold the designs and the right to manufacture to a couple different companies, one of which is Cortelco. So I've had older Western Electric phones. I can tell you the plastic
feels different, not necessarily worse or cheaper, but just different. But the dimensions are all the same. The innards are all the same, and there's really no difference. It's still got the bell ringers in there. There are no modern electronics. And that's the 2500. Its cousin is the I believe the 2554. And this is actually hooked up to the main house line, which again goes into my my home PBX. So this one's actually functional right now. Really the only difference, there's exact same guts between here and here, is just it's in a wall mountable shape. So that's, now if you want to use these today and you don't have a regular phone line, what do you do? As I mentioned before, I use an ATA adapter, and it just combines, this is a bad example here, I'll get into that in a sec, but two lines in, and why are you not focusing? Two lines in, and Ethernet, and it translates this, between POTS and SIP. So there's really not much much to it. There's a lot of trying to get the autofocus here off. there's a lot of configuration inside these units for different setups and whatnot, but not really a lot of functional difference. You pick up the phone, it makes a dial tone, you dial, it sends to a SIP server. And I mentioned the power over Ethernet. This started with a PAP2. Excuse me. I've actually got a PAP2NA. This is a PAP2T, which is an upgraded model. I wish I could get it to autofocus, but oh well. And then after that, or about the same time of that, came the Sapura SPA3102, which is basically an ATA adapter with a built-in broadband router. So you could put this at remote sites and, you know, have it dial home and have remote access for VoIP stuff. This one is the SPA112, which is actually just brand new. It's basically Cisco refreshing their line, but this does pretty much the exact same as these. And so that's it for the esoteric phones. Excuse me. These are the Cisco SPA509G on the right and 504G on the left. The SPA model identifier actually comes from Sapura, which is a company that Linksys bought, and then Cisco bought Linksys. So they've actually continued that model number scheme throughout here. So these phones are actually still being built. They were introduced around 2009, and they're just fully featured SIP, VoIP, PBX desk phones. The 504 I actually use once every couple days. It sits on my desk in my office. It's tied into my home PBX. My home PBX is tied into the to my company's PBX, so I can just lift the handset, dial my boss, you know, have our weekly one-on-one, and yeah, it just works. Actually, kind of hard to, yeah, you can't really make it out on here, but there's actually discoloration where the redial button is, because that's frankly mostly what I use it for, is redialing my boss once a week. I have the 509G, just don't really use it that much. The difference between the 509 and the 504, 504 has four lines on it. 509 has 12. I don't know why they didn't call it the 512G, but so the four on the left, four on the right, and four on the bottom. And then in addition, there is, where is that? There's an extra port somewhere around here. It's
designed to take a what's called a tenant console, basically just adding a ton more direct dial and transfer lines. The 509 is designed to be on like a receptionist desk for quick transfer through throughout the company. But aside from that, these are configured almost exactly the same. So yeah, that is my phone collection, or part of it. And I will be posting some information in the description here to links that I've found if you are interested in making your or buying and converting your own payphone. But thank you.